Scotty Reed here with a Black Talk Radio News Report. On this particular segment, we'll be taking a look at a vote that occurred in Puerto Rico pertaining to becoming a 51st state of the United States of America. Most of the corporate state outlets, news outlets, are not giving you a lot of contextual information as it regards to the status of Puerto Rico as a commonwealth or a colonial possession of the United States. Earlier, I was able to speak to Puerto Rican filmmaker Vagabond Beaumont about this very issue. I think you will be enlightened by this interview. News outlets are reporting that a referendum vote was held over the weekend in Puerto Rico, the small occupied island nation, which finds itself a colonial possession of the United States of America, Incorporated. The referendum asked voters to say yes or no to becoming the 51st state of USA. The referendum was heavily boycotted, according to reports, and of those who did vote, a majority voted to give up hopes of Puerto Rico regaining its sovereign nation status. Joining us to give his perspective on the referendum, the vote, and the occupation is filmmaker Vagabond Beaumont, whose international award-winning dramatic film, Machetero, touches on the real-life issues facing Puerto Ricans when it comes to their homeland. Vagabond, before we get to the referendum vote, please give us a quick plug of your film, which is available on demand.
Yeah, Vimeo, it's on demand. And on Vimeo, so if you type in vimeo.com/on-demand/Machetero, that's spelled M-A-C-H-E-T-E-R-O, you'll be able to find it. If you just type in Machetero Vimeo, V-I-M-E-O, you'll be able to find it. It's not hard to find. And the film's won 6 awards all around the world. It stars Isaac Defuncole, who, incidentally, he's been in a lot of films. He was in Casino Royale. He plays the African, quote-unquote, terrorist that James Bond is fighting against in Casino Royale. He's worked with Jim Jarmusch. He's worked with Claire Denis. He's worked with a lot of heavy-hitter directors, Michael Mann, and he's in this film. And it's a hard-hitting film about the Puerto Rican independence movement that explores the violent aspects of anti-imperialism in Puerto Rico.
Vagabond, what was your initial reaction to hearing the news about the outcome of the vote on whether Puerto Rico gives up its claims to sovereignty?
Well, with every one of these plebiscites, the plebiscites are a joke. I mean, just from the very beginning, they're non-binding, which means that, you know, if everyone had voted, if every Puerto Rican on the island had voted and had voted for anything, independent statehood, whatever it was, the U.S. Congress would still have to make the final decision. And that decision doesn't necessarily have to be what Puerto Ricans decide. So it's like a giant opinion poll that is essentially a tool for the U.S. to continue its colonialist operation. It makes Puerto Ricans look stupid, you know, like we can't get together. It is a conquer and divide tactic. We are a conquered people, and in order for us to remain conquered, we need to be divided. And so every plebiscite from 1967 on, I think 1967 was the first one, coming forward to this last one is a sham. It's a waste of money. Here's the other problem. You mentioned that, you know, Puerto Rico has this massive debt crisis. I don't really call it a debt crisis. People like to call it the Puerto Rican debt crisis. I don't call it that. I said that the United States has a debt crisis in Puerto Rico because Puerto Rico is a colony of the United States. The United States runs Puerto Rico. So if you're in charge of the island, then you're in charge of its debt. So the U.S. has a debt problem in Puerto Rico that doesn't want to pay. It wants Puerto Ricans to pay some sort of $74 billion debt. That doesn't make any sense. None of it makes any sense. And so this plebiscite, with all the debt problems that you're having with this plebiscite, to come in, I think the plebiscite cost something like $8 million to produce. Meanwhile, schools are being closed. Hospitals are being closed. Social services are being cut back. People are losing their jobs. And yet somehow there's money for a plebiscite, which means nothing. Absolutely nothing. It's a glorified opinion poll.
I think that's a good way to describe it as an opinion poll. Now, the timing of the plebiscite seems rather intentional, given that Oscar Lopez Rivera, a longtime political prisoner in prison for his independence activities on behalf of Puerto Rico. Had you considered the timing of his release in this plebiscite?
I think that the plebiscite, I think that's kind of, I feel that's just a bonus for statehooders. We have a statehood supporting governor in Puerto Rico. So this is going to sound bizarre, so I have to give a little bit of background information. So up until the late 40s, governors were installed in Puerto Rico. So from 1898, Puerto Rico has been a colony in the United States since 1898 during the Spanish-American War. When the United States won the war, the Spanish-American War, it asked for $20 million in reparations. And this is in 1898, so this is the fastest sum of money. Spain couldn't pay, so they gave them Guam, Philippines, and Puerto Rico. So essentially, the funny part is that in 1897, Puerto Rico had been negotiating more autonomy from Spain. They had been a colony of Spain since the 1500s. They had been negotiating its autonomy with Spain, and right when things were starting to take off in that direction, the Spanish-American War happened, and Puerto Rico went from being a colony of Spain to being a colony of the United States. In the 1940s, the U.S. started to open up elections for Puerto Ricans to vote for a Puerto Rican governor. Up until that time, this was a position that each president installed in Puerto Rico. Part of this is, now the problem with Puerto Rico having a legislature and a governor and all the trappings of a democracy is that any law that Puerto Rico, that the Puerto Rican legislature, the Puerto Rican governor puts forth can be struck down by the U.S. Congress, which is the very definition of colonialism. So the plebiscites have always been, there have always been these two parties in Puerto Rico who have been sort of ping-ponging back and forth with this colonial governorship and this colonial, heading this colonial government in Puerto Rico. And that has been Commonwealth, which is how people define the colony or how the United States defines the colony. Proper terminology is that Puerto Rico is a freely associated state of the United States, or a Commonwealth, the Commonwealth territory. So there's been a Commonwealth party that's been struggling to keep things as they are. There's a statehood party that is fighting for Puerto Rican statehood. And then there's the independent party. The Commonwealthers and the statehooders have always ping-ponged back and forth with governorships. Every plebiscite has always been brought forth by one of those two parties. And every one of those plebiscites has always, the outcome has always favored those two parties. So it's a very strange thing. The other problem with the plebiscite situation is that it's difficult for people to vote for independence if they've never had it. So if I use the example, so like if I'm Scotty, let's say I'm going to sell you my car, and I tell you what it is, and you say, okay, cool, can I come by and give it a test drive, take a look at it, make sure, you know, everything's running, and I know what you said, but I don't know, I want to see it for myself. And I said to you, no, you got to buy it as is, right here, right now, you can't even look at it. You would say, no, I'm not buying that. And that's the same thing, that's the same issue that we have with the plebiscite in terms of independence. Puerto Rico has never had complete and total autonomy. There are people who believe on the island and in the diaspora that that is the only solution. I count myself as among them. But a true plebiscite, according to United Nations regulations, would have to mean that Puerto Rico would have to have total and complete autonomy from the U.S. so that for a period of at least 10 years, and at the end of that 10-year period, then a plebiscite could happen. But and the plebiscite would have to be binding. Then the will of the Puerto Rican people, you would understand the will of the Puerto Rican people. The Puerto Rican people would also understand what their choices are. We have an idea of what statehood might look like. We know what colonialism looks like. We just have never, ever had an opportunity to know what independence is. And so asking people to vote for something that they've never had the opportunity to exercise is a little disingenuous, to say the very least. And so these plebiscites are really, they're just colonial tools used so that people can be even more confused about the status of Puerto Rico. When I was showing my film Machu Picchu, and I was going all over the world with it. The first award we ever won was in South Africa. People were shocked that Puerto Rico was a colony in the United States. The reason being is because Puerto Rico gets to compete in the Olympics and the Pan American Games and other games in which countries compete. They get to compete as a country. They get to compete as a nation. When the Miss Universe pageant comes along, or the Miss World, or the beauty pageants happen, Puerto Rico competes as a nation. When you fly from the United States to Puerto Rico, it is an international flight. These are things that, in my estimation, the U.S. government has done on purpose so that people are confused as to what the relationship was with the United States, or that Puerto Rico has with the United States.
So when you say people, you mean the international community. And I have to be honest with you, Vagabond, I never even considered that. And you are exactly right about them competing as a nation in sporting events, in the Miss Universe pageant. And I never considered that, hey, how can they be represented as an independent nation at these events when they're still colonized? So thank you for enlightening me, or making me aware of that contradiction.
And that's sort of like window dressing, right? So that people are confused. And so, and the funny thing is that those things sort of cut both ways. Like, one of the reasons that people don't want to become a state is that if they become a state, they lose. They now become a part of the U.S. Olympic team, or they have to compete in the Pan American Games as the United States. And people don't want that to happen. They don't want to do that. That's not something that they're willing to give up. They also, you know, on a really silly sort of level, they don't want to give up the Miss Universe pageant. I said, if I'm not mistaken, the last time I checked, and this was a few years ago, Puerto Rico has been Miss Universe for 5 times in its history. I think the only other country that can claim that is Venezuela. And there's always been this sort of friendly competition between Venezuela and Puerto Rico. And people don't want to give that up. I know it sounds ridiculous. It sounds stupid. But it's these kinds of things that sort of, it's silly. It sounds silly and stupid on a certain level. But on another level, when you dig deeper, there's a certain amount of pride in being able to say that Miss Universe is from Puerto Rico, that she came from our country. And that kind of thing sort of can't really be denied. So as much as the United States uses it to confuse the international community, it also fosters resistance within the colony itself.
Psychological operation.
It's a double-sided sword for them.
Right. It's a psyops, psychological operation on the people themselves.
Of course. Yes. Yes. And that's my argument again with the debt, the U.S. debt crisis, right? So the U.S. can, here's the funny part. I saw a statistic, and this was maybe 2 years ago. I saw a statistic in which the United States gives $4 billion in aid to Puerto Rico. And that's not, it's just, like, that's like CAP and Pell Grant, Social Security. Social Security shouldn't even count because people actually pay into Social Security. So that's not something that they're getting for free. People actually pay into that. But those kinds of things, the kinds of things that most everybody would get in the United States, Social Security, CAP and Pell Grant, you know, Section 8 housing, WIC, all those kinds of things. $4 billion comes from the United States coffers, goes to Puerto Rico. That $4 billion down payment, that $4 billion investment, in that investment, the U.S. takes $74 billion out of the Puerto Rican economy. It makes $74 billion a year. And it's really strange that every single year, $74 billion is being made in the U.S. off of Puerto Rico, and somehow Puerto Ricans owe $74 billion in debt. Just like you have the Miss Universe pageant cutting both ways, and the Olympic team cutting both ways, where it serves as a distraction and confusion, and like you said, psychological operations for international community, but at the same time, it also gives a reason for people not to want to be a state or a colony within the diaspora and within the island itself. And the same way that that cuts both ways, that my argument is that we Puerto Ricans shouldn't be expending a single iota, a single scintilla of energy trying to figure out how to pay this debt, because the U.S. has been in control of Puerto Rico since 1898. And if they're in control, then the debt is theirs.
Right.
It's not ours.
Right.
And where is the $74 billion? That's the first question. How did this number come about? How did this number come about? Can you prove to, if you're at a restaurant and you sit down and you have a meal with a big group of people and so on and so forth, and you look at the bill, and you go to a restaurant and you look at the menu and you know how much things cost, and you look around and you say, if you're the guy that's going to pay, right? Let's say you're going to a big party, you've got 10 or 15 people, you figure out, okay, this dinner may cost me $600 between drinks and food and so on and so forth. It's about $600. And the bill comes and it's $900. You're going to go over that bill and go, wait a second, this was not what I had estimated. I need to look at this. And who ordered this? We didn't order this and we didn't order that, right?
Right.
$74 billion, nobody's going over it and saying, where did this number come from? And how did it happen? Right. I want to know why nobody's sitting there going, we need to check out where this came from. Not to mention that this debt has only come up now because it was bought by Wall Street speculators. What happened was this debt had been going on for the longest, and the original people who had owned the debt, who had made the loan and couldn't get the money from Puerto Rico, sold the debt for as little as 34 cents on the dollar to Wall Street speculators. Now Wall Street speculators are coming and saying, we want the whole dollar from Puerto Rico, plus interest.
But like you said, Vagabond, they should be presenting that bill to the U.S. Congress and not the people of Puerto Rico.
Exactly. You know, if you were in charge of the whole island and you had oversight, like I had mentioned earlier, there are no laws. The Puerto Rican legislature and the Puerto Rican governor cannot do anything that the U.S. Congress does not want them to do. I'll give you an example. There is the Jones Act. The Jones Act of 1917. The Jones Act made Puerto Ricans U.S. citizens, American citizens, without asking them, without consulting them, so on and so forth. It also included a maritime law. The maritime law stated that any ship that comes to the U.S. cannot stop at more than one U.S. port at a time. So in other words, let's say a more modern example. Honda and Toyota are sending cars to Puerto Rico, right? The ship comes through the Panama Canal, stops in Puerto Rico. If it stops in Puerto Rico, it can't go, say, to you in North Carolina or Baltimore. It cannot do that legally, according to the Jones Act. So what happens is cars from Toyota and Honda that are on a shipping container, that are in a shipping container that come through the Panama Canal, go, say, to Baltimore. They get taken off the ship there and then put onto another ship that goes specifically straight to Puerto Rico. They literally bypass Puerto Rico to go, say, someplace like Baltimore, and then from Baltimore back to Puerto Rico. The cars now cost 40% more in Puerto Rico than they would if they had just stopped along the way. And they can't. Illegal for international ships. All the ships that dock in Puerto Rico have to be from the U.S. They have to fly a U.S. flag. They have to be a U.S. crew and so on and so forth. I mean, it doesn't get the glaring, tactics of colonialism don't get any sharper or brighter than this.
And then you wonder why
we have a $74 billion debt.
My last question, you kind of answered it over the course of this interview, but there are reports that only a very, very, very small minority of Puerto Ricans actually participated in this plebiscite. Why do you think the larger population did not participate, and has it always been this way? Do they look at it and know it to be a shame, being that it's non-binding, or what do we make of that?
Well, people who believe in independence have always, a large number of the independent supporters don't participate in any plebiscite simply because it's non-binding, right? And so that's always been that. So in other words, if you look at these plebiscites, independence usually gets about 5% of the vote, right? The reason I think that people aren't really interested in a plebiscite right now, in terms of, the turnout was like 23% or 27% of the island's population. Now, Puerto Ricans have a history of really turning out to vote. Their voting is usually about 80%. It's really hot, and it's about 80% when there's an election. There's an 80%, participation rate. So for this election to have a 23 or 27% participation rate, it just speaks to the idea that people are tired of all this silliness. I think that what has happened is that people are starting to realize that the empire has no clothes. I don't think that people are really concerned about the status issue right now in terms of the ongoing debt crisis in Puerto Rico. There was a group that was put together by the U.S. That was called PROMESA. I forget what it stands for, but PROMESA in Spanish means promise, right? And the PROMESA is overriding anything that the Puerto Rican legislature wants to deal with in terms of this debt. So Puerto Rico wanted to claim bankruptcy and not be able to pay the debt, but the U.S. Congress said that they couldn't claim bankruptcy. Then Wall Street asked for austerity measures, and the Puerto Rican legislature said, no, we don't think that austerity will work. When the legislature said it wouldn't work, this U.S. Congress essentially put into place this thing called PROMESA, this group, small elite group that would make the decision. That's the group that's closing hospitals and closing schools and cutting all kinds of services in Puerto Rico. This is the same group that had no problem allowing $8 million to be spent on a plebiscite. And I think that when people saw that, they were like, this doesn't work for us. Like, this is not in the priority of things. This is not what we need right now. $8 million on a plebiscite when schools are closing and hospitals are closing and services are being cut. And I think that people were like, no. I also, the other part of it was that Commonwealth people who are, the Commonwealth Party was saying that they don't want their people to participate in the plebiscite. So essentially, it's almost like I'm going to have a vote. I'm going to call for a vote. There are three of us in the room. I'm going to call for a vote, and two of us don't vote.
Right.
And then I declare myself the winner. It's absurdity. It's spectacle. It's political theater. And I think that people were not interested in any of it whatsoever. They were just like, no, this is not a priority. And I agree. I mean, most of the time, I'm always saying that, you know, independence will solve our problem. It may or may not. But I think that independence has the greatest chance of solving our problem. Because right now, if we came up with a solution and the U.S. Congress didn't like it, they could strike it down.
Which again, Vagabond, just illustrates or really bolsters your point that if Congress can shoot down anything that the people, legislatures themselves, Puerto Rican legislatures, come up with themselves, then that goes to show you that the United States is responsible for this debt. They're in total control.
Exactly.
Wow.
You know, look, I always quote, I tell people, you know, that people, the independence thing, the problem with independence or people not wanting to support independence is that they claim that they don't want to be Haiti or the Dominican Republic in terms of the economic issues that those nations face, right?
Okay.
That's a valid concern, right? So in other words, when you speak about independence, the problem with, if there is an independence party in Puerto Rico, the problem I have with the independence party is that it doesn't really address in any way that people are understanding the economic realities of what independence means. That's a valid concern. People sitting there saying, listen, right now I'm getting food stamps, Section 8, and WIC. If we become independent, how do I sustain myself? I mean, that question needs to be answered. It definitely needs to be answered. But I always go back to this thing where I tell people, if the U.S. Congress decided to cut your WIC, your Section 8, and your food stamps, that would be it for you. So what I'm saying is, don't wait for that to happen, but have your independence and be able to solve your problems yourself. I always quote Kwame Nkrumah. Kwame Nkrumah said it is far, far better to govern or misgovern oneself than to be governed by someone else. And this is this plebiscite, this debt issue in Puerto Rico, it doesn't get any more raw or naked than that. I mean, it just proves Kwame Nkrumah's point. Even if we were to be in the same situation as an independent nation as we are right now as a colony, we would at least be able to have the power to solve the situation ourselves, rather than having Wall Street tycoons deciding austerity and the U.S. Congress backing every move. And I also feel, and this is something that I feel like the real issue about this debt is not to get the debt back. I don't think that Wall Street or the U.S. Congress or any of these entities are concerned with Puerto Ricans paying back this astronomical debt. I think that this is a massive island-wide gentrification process. That's what I think. I live in New York. I've lived in New York all my life. I was born in the People's Republic of Brooklyn. There were neighborhoods in Brooklyn. The first neighborhoods in New York City to be gentrified were always Puerto Rican neighborhoods. And I mean always Puerto Rican neighborhoods. Lower East Side, Puerto Rican neighborhood, gentrified. Williamsburg, Brooklyn, Puerto Rican neighborhood, gentrified. East Harlem, in the process of gentrification, Puerto Rican neighborhood. South Bronx in the process of gentrification, and the places that were the most gentrified were Puerto Rican communities. And the tactic that was used then was to bankrupt those communities, to police them heavily, and then to make property values plummet so that speculators could come in, swoop in, buy everything up for cheap, and gentrify the area. I think that's what's happening. I think that the debt crisis is an excuse to gentrify the island, and that it's already started. There are billionaire speculators who have gone in and bought tons of property in Puerto Rico already. And I think that within 5 to 10 years, Puerto Rico will be, the whole island will be gentrified. I think that we had a Puerto Rican independence leader named Pedro Albizu Campos. Pedro Albizu Campos was sort of like the Puerto Rican Malcolm X. Here's the funny part, though. He actually lived before Malcolm. He was born in 1894, I think, if I'm not mistaken, and he died in 1965, and he was actually an influence on Malcolm. But he was sort of like the Puerto Rican Malcolm X. And he said that the Americans want the birdcage without the bird. In other words, right. The United States wants Puerto Rico without Puerto Rico. And I think this whole debt crisis is a means to an end. It is not a means unto itself. Not an end unto itself. It is a means towards something else. And I think it's that.
I would have to say that is a totally plausible explanation. It makes total sense to me. Well, I want to thank you for speaking with BTR News on the issues today, Mr. Vagabond Beaumont. Before we leave, please tell people about your film and how they can access it again.
Sure. My film is Machetero. It's about the Puerto Rican independence movement. You can find it on Vimeo, Vimeo.com/on-demand Machetero, Machetero. And I'm working on a couple of other different projects right now. Right now I'm working on a documentary on Abiaduno Yawole of The Last Poet. And it's called Harlem's Last Poet. And if you look up Harlem's Last Poet, either online or on Facebook, you'll find the page. You can be updated. We don't know when we're going to finish that film, but we're about 40% of the way through and hoping to finish before the end of the year. But that all depends on financing and that's always a difficult thing to try and predict. So, but in the meantime, people can check out Machetero. They can also follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @V as in Victor, G as in Girl, B as in Boy, N as in Nancy, D as in Dog. I'm also on Instagram, same thing, VGBND. And you can find me on Facebook and all of those kinds of things. I'm an easy person to find. So, but thanks for having me, Scotty. I really appreciate it, man.
Thank you. We certainly appreciate the work that you are involved in. Thank you for watching this Black Talk Radio News segment. Remember, you can support the production of independent media by making a donation to the nonprofit Black Talk Media Project. You can also subscribe to other independent podcast producers at blacktalkradionetwork.com. You can also join our new social media community, which is found at btrcommunity.com. Subscribe.